Hey everyone, and welcome to Faith. My name is Matt, and we are so glad that you've decided to join us today. Wherever you may be watching from and whoever you may be watching with, we just want to say thank you for deciding to spend the next 45 minutes or so with us today, as we're going to sing a few songs together and we're going to hear a message from Pastor Doug. And we would love for you to share this stream on your social media. It's one of the best ways that we believe we can spread what we're doing across New England with as many people as we possibly can. And if you want to partner with us today, the best way to do that is simply by going to faithauburn.info and clicking the button that says give. You can give a one-time gift, or you can have a scheduled regular gift set up as well. And it's because of your generosity that we're able to do what we do today. So thank you for your generosity. And lastly, and most importantly, we want you to connect in two ways today. Number one, to connect with God. And part of that is just setting aside the distractions. Put your phone on Do Not Disturb, gather the whole family, and do whatever it takes, whatever you need to do to stop, lean in, and reconnect with your Heavenly Father. The second way we'd encourage you to connect today is to connect with other people. You can connect with others in the chat, or you can attend one of our in-person services, which happen every Sunday at 9 or 11 a.m. With all that being said, the moment you're waiting for is about to begin. Our weekend service is here, and it all starts right now.
Everybody loves a good plot twist, like the one in The Sixth Sense, or The Empire Strikes Back, Luke, I am your father. Or, like the best movie of all time, at least according to some critics, the 1941 classic Citizen Kane. In Citizen Kane, journalist Charles Foster Kane dies at the beginning of the movie, and his last words are, Rosebud. And you don't know who or what Rosebud actually was or is. The movie tracks the life of Kane as we, the viewers, attempt to discover what these enigmatic final words mean. And in the last moments of the flick, we discover that Rosebud does not refer to a person or a place, but you're going to have to find out for yourself on that one. Have you ever had one of those didn't see it coming moments? You know, kind of a surprise ending? So we had one about a week ago when my wife and I were attending a Woo Sox game at Polar Park. I mean, I thought it was a stunt at first. So here's a boyfriend gets down on one knee to propose to his girlfriend, and then it goes horribly wrong. She publicly rejects him and runs away. The would-be romantic gesture prompted cheers from the crowd, but instead of swooning, his stunned girlfriend puts her hands over her mouth and shook her head no. I have to go, she was heard saying before she bolted up through the crowds, leaving him alone there on one knee. I mean, what a surprise ending. The story of Jonah ends today with a didn't see it coming ending. It's a startling, shocking ending to the whole story of Jonah. One could say that today's story in Jonah chapter 4, the last chapter of Jonah, is perhaps the most surprising chapter in the entire Bible. If you had to give it a title, you might call it The Remarkable Ruin of Jonah Again. After many detours along the way, Jonah is right back to where he started. It's hard to believe that he's back into his old ways once again, our prodigal prophet who is redeemed from the belly of the fish has a remarkable turnaround and then falls once again back into old sinful patterns of selfish behavior, and this time it's ugly. I mean, really ugly. Last we left Jonah, he had just traveled through the entire city of Nineveh preaching a message of judgment and condemnation. this vile and ruthless city was being told that they had 40 days and then they would be demolished, destroyed. Now, I want you to put yourself in Jonah's sandals for a moment. All right, Jonah, the Israelite prophet, is walking into enemy territory, one of the world's worst nations ever to have inhabited the planet. I mean, they made the Nazis look good. They had committed genocide against whole populations in such a way that made what other evil nations did look like child's play. And Jonah is commanded by God to go into the city and preach against it, a message of hellfire and brimstone, because this city wholeheartedly deserved it. Now, I could see it may be a little hard for us to feel what Jonah felt. So let me try to illustrate. I mean, what would it really look like to walk into the evil empire and preach against it? What would be similar in our day to march into the enemy camp and bring a word against the evil empire? Oh, wait, I got it. So last week, my son Jonathan and I, we took a trip to the Bronx. Here we are in enemy territory, surrounded by the evil empire. I was called many names, not any of which I could share with you today right now. The only time I feared for my life was on the subway train after the game back to Grand Central, after we had just blanked the Yankees 4-0. We were packed into a subway car with Yankee fans all around us, most of them inebriated, shoving, slapping us upside the head, and all I could say was, "Go Red Sox!" No, I didn't say that really, no. Now imagine Jonah walking through this despicable city yelling, "The end is near, turn or burn, 40 days and then the fiery blaze, let's go Yahweh!" Yeah, and then the unthinkable, unimaginable, unbelievable happens. The city repents and God relents. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. That's how chapter 3 ends. Who would have seen that coming? It would be like everybody on that subway car getting down on their knees and crying out, "The Red Sox rule, they are the king." I mean, it never happened. But it did for Jonah. Jonah has been the prime mover and shaker of the largest conversion story ever. Now, how should the end of the story be written? Jonah 3:11 should then read this. "And Jonah returned home, rejoicing over all that God had done through him. And the rest of his exploits are written in his top-selling book, 5 Easy Steps to Lead a Successful Revival," in our lobby, available today on sale. "And Jonah did many book tours and lived happily ever after." Isn't that how it should end? But it doesn't end this way. Jonah 4:1 says this, "But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry." That the Ninevites would repent and God would relent, Jonah was a little displeased, a little bent out of joint. Do you know what it really says? The literal translation is, it was evil to Jonah, with great evil. Jonah literally hated what God had done or not done. To Jonah, the deliverance of Nineveh was an evil thing. What pleased God displeased the prophet. Is there anything more ridiculous than that? Now, how would you respond if you were Jonah? I know most pastors that I know would love to be on the front end of a revival like this. This would be the highlight of a pastor's career. We're faced with a profoundly challenging theological question here, and it's this. Huh? What? Why? It doesn't make sense. The bomb didn't go off. It was diffused by their change of heart, and he's boiling mad. The word angry here means to be highly indignant, or literally hot about it. He's red hot and bothered that they weren't wiped out. What greatly pleased God highly displeased Jonah the pouting prophet. Now let me ask you, do ball players get exceedingly angry when they get promoted to the majors? Do authors get upset when their novels get published and hit the New York Times bestsellers list? And does a pastor get upset when their congregation responds favorably to the morning message? No, of course not. No one would have expected for Jonah to react in the way that he did. What pleased God greatly displeases Jonah to the core. He is so upset that his preaching had actually taken effect. The greatest, most powerful, most despicable city in the world has just experienced a wholesale turnaround toward your God, and you're not buying it. You're not rejoicing in it. Jonah has just planted a megachurch with hundreds of different campuses throughout the city, and yet he's bent beyond belief. And now we find out exactly why. Jonah 4:2 says this. He prayed to the Lord, "Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That it is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish? I knew that you were a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity." Ah, now we see it. It's not a case of fright, but a case of spite. He hates them and wants them to die. In chapter 1, Jonah wanted to get as far away from Nineveh as possible, not because he's afraid, but because he loathes the Ninevites. They need to die. You see, there's something in Jonah that scholars have seen and commented on throughout the centuries, an idolatry of nationalism that fuels his racism. The sin that Jonah displays in chapter 1 is back with a vengeance in chapter 4. It's a hatred towards others who are not like him. How easy it is for believers to fall back into old habits of sin, self-deception, selfishness, and even hypercriticism towards others. I think the longer we are believers in God, the more we can develop a kind of heartless faith. It happens when we do not allow our hearts to be formed and molded and shaped by the grace and mercy of God. And we instead look down on our bony noses at other poor, unfortunate pagans, and we simply don't care. See, here's my fear, that many of us are today committing the very sin of Jonah, and we don't even realize it. This past week, I listened to one of John Ortberg's sermons, maybe some of you know John Ortberg, which included a rather unusual depiction of God's call and the prophet's refusal to go. Now, you may not know this, but John Ortberg is a big Dr. Seuss fan, and he occasionally likes to speak in Dr. Seuss verse. So let's go with it, okay? "Could you, would you go to preach? Could you, would you go to reach the people in Assyria? For you fit my criteria. I would not go there in a boat. I would not go there in a float. I would not go there in a gale. I would not go there in a whale. I do not like the people there. If they all died, I would not care. I will not go to that great town. I'd rather choke. I'd rather drown. I will not go by land or sea. So stop this talk and let me be." I mean, doesn't that just sum up the attitude of Jonah in a kind of a humorous way? But this is it. This is it for him and how he's dealing with things. This sums up his attitude. But this is the serious question for all of us today. Is there too great a gap between your love and God's love? What I mean is this: is there too great a distance between your love for people and God's love for the same people? Jonah is struggling with the extravagant love of God for others, for other people who he believes are unworthy. God is too patient, too loving, too forgiving. You see, the word extravagant in the dictionary means that which exceeds the limits of human reason or necessity. To Jonah, these dirty, rotten Ninevites are beyond the reasonable limits of God's love. God's love is for those who deserve it, not for the undeserving. For those who mostly have their act together, those whose hearts are mostly right, whose actions are mostly upstanding. He's upset that God is promiscuous with his love, that he lavishes it upon wicked people, regardless of their past, regardless of their race, regardless of their unsavory background. Those tattooed, skinny jean Ninevites aren't worth saving. 16 years ago, when assessing the relief plan that went awry during Hurricane Katrina, remember that? A plain-speaking, cigar-chomping Army general by the name of Russell Honoré set the tone with the media for how to respond to a disaster when the federal government had initially proven kind of hapless and hopeless. He put it bluntly, don't get stuck on stupid. That's what Jonah has done here. He's gotten stuck on stupid. And it shows in living color when he says this in the next verse. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live. Jonah, well, I mean, what a drama queen. Can you believe this? How utterly senseless of Jonah to feel this way at this moment in his life. It reveals something very disturbing about his character. Jonah would rather die than see the Ninevites live. Jonah did not wish to live any longer because God had not carried out Nineveh's judgment. Nineveh's redemption had utterly depressed him. My reason to live is gone. I've got no meaning in life because God didn't blow them up. My reason to get up out of bed in the morning is gone. Jonah is suicidal because God is gracious and loving. I mean, his attitude, it makes no sense for a person of God. Jonah is stuck on stupid, and tragically, he's not alone. It's not an anomaly. To many believers that I know who get stuck on stupid, just like Jonah, we can be orthodox in our faith, faithful in our church attendance. We're givers, we read our Bibles, we pray regularly, and still be stuck on stupid. At this point, Jonah has such a narrow and limited understanding of God's love. I kind of fear that much of our problem in the evangelical church today is the same as Jonah. We really don't understand how the love of God operates. And there's too great a gap between our love for others and God's love for others. The next verse says this, but the Lord replied, is it right for you to be angry? In other words, is it justifiable? Is it good? Don't you just love the rhetorical questions of God, those questions that, you know, you already know the answer for? The obvious answer is no. No, it's not good that you should be so unloving, so filled with hatred. Here's the plain truth. What Jonah doesn't realize, the only thing keeping God from wiping Jonah off the planet is the very same patience that God had for the Ninevites. Only the patient love of God stands between him right now and being eternally snuffed out. He is so far off the mark here because he doesn't realize that he's no better off than these pagan Ninevites. And to show how far off the mark he is, God does a little experiment on him. Jonah's anger is so inappropriate that God is now, he's now going to make Jonah kind of understand with an organic object lesson. Verse 5 puts it this way. Jonah had gone out, sat down at a place east of the city. There he made himself a shelter, sat in its shade, and waited to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord God provided a leafy plant and made it grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm which chewed the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint, he wanted to die and said, it would be better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the plant? It is, he said, and I'm so angry, I wish I were dead. Oh my, oh my. I mean, Jonah is in such a bad place right now. He's more concerned about his own comfort with his precious shade tree rather than the lives of people created in God's image. Jonah is immature with a capital I. In effect, he's saying, my race is better than your race and every other race can go to, you know, H-E double hockey stick. God, you bleeding heart liberal you, you'll forgive anybody, any half-hearted apology, and you give them a second chance. Jonah's worldview is so narrow right now. It's so not oriented toward the things of God and the priorities of God, but around himself, his own creaturely comforts and his own people. The ugliness of his heart gets even uglier because when he leaves the city, he's sitting sulking in the scorching sun, waiting for the city to be scorched by God's judgment, still hoping something bad is going to happen to it. And he's so upset, getting sunburned, that he wants to die. So God provides a miraculous leafy plant to grow quickly in one day, then provides a worm to eat it, then provides a scorching east wind to break the prophet. Do you notice something? It's the same word used in chapter 1 of God providing the miracle fish. God is trying to expose the prophet's callous heart. Does anyone else see how absolutely fickle Jonah is here? He's angry they don't get scorched. Now he's happy that he's not getting scorched. But then once again, his rejoicing turns to outrage when God sends a worm to kill the plant. He's flip-flopping back and forth. He is bent out of shape that his shade tree is gone. His creature comforts have been taken away. And notice, it's God who's taken it away. God's trying to make a point by killing off this leafy plant. This is an object lesson for the prophet and for us for generations to come. Jonah thinks he worships Yahweh, when in fact, Jonah has another God. It's an idolatry of his own nation, a nationalism, and the national security of his own people. He suffers from, I guess we could say, xenophobia, you know, that fear of foreigners. It's not just fear, but downright hatred towards them. Jonah is a patriot who's allowed his patriotism to turn to gruesome bloodlust. His love for his own people only has turned into an idol. The same is true in the day of Jesus by many Jews who despised the Gentiles. It was a nationalism that was for Jonah a false rival God and that prevented him from wishing God's blessing upon the nations. He was using the true God as a means to an end. Let God wipe out the rest of the world. Jonah is selfish and only his happiness matters. It begs the question of all of us. Do we see ourselves better than anyone else on the planet? Or is our happiness all that matters? Do we care that at this very hour, millions are dying and walking into a Christless eternity? God cares, and so ought we also to care. God is trying to give Jonah a world vision, a vision for the whole wide world that's bigger than his own little myopic viewpoint. But Jonah is stuck in the sin of pride, prejudice, self-interest. He's stuck on stupid. Jonah believes that he has arrived, that his nation, the nation of Israel, has arrived, and that only they are worthy of God's loving kindness. Now, here's what's so very odd to me. I mean, hear me out on this one. Jonah was a prophet from the northern kingdom. Think about that one. The northern kingdom of Israel that was known for their own idolatry, their wanton idolatry, and chasing after the gods of the foreign nations around them. They were in a worse condition because they knew the truth. They knew the one true God, but turned their backs on him. So how on earth can Jonah feel so superior when he's from a nation of backsliders? You see, this is one of my own fears, that we would similarly ignore our own issues, you know, and start feeling kind of moral superiority towards outsiders, just like Jonah. The only thing that makes us different from others is we've heard the good news and we've received it, but we're no better off than anyone else. We're better off, perhaps, we're no better than, but we're better off because of what Jesus has done. Make no mistake, we're not superior to any other people on the planet. In short, we simply can't fathom how big, how broad, how wide is the love of God for all people on earth, but we better start trying. Jonah 4:10 then says this, "Then the Lord said, 'You feel sorry about the plant, though you did nothing to put it there. It came quickly and died quickly.'" You feel sorry about the plant. The word here is the word to mourn over, to grieve over, to have a kind of a gut-wrenching compassion for. You grieve for the plant, but not the people? How incredibly ridiculous that is. You're standing on the sidelines waiting for me to nuke the Ninevites. There's something wrong with that. The Lord is driving home Jonah's inappropriate concern for an inanimate object and his lack of concern for people. People who've been created by God and who are precious to him. He teaches Jonah a lesson by inflicting a little discomfort in Jonah's life, a little sunburn, because I'll tell you this, it's better for your skin to burn than your eternal soul to burn. God loves Jonah way too much to let him just go his own way. The same was true of the Ninevites. God will remove our earthly life rafts so he can get our attention to turn our hearts back to himself. He's rattling Jonah's cage by removing his leafy tree in order to get him back on track again. Jonah's living on the edge of emotional disaster right now by loving far less than the way God desires. Now comes the whole point of the story in the very last verse of the book of Jonah. But Nineveh has more than 120,000 people living in spiritual darkness, not to mention all the animals. Shouldn't I feel sorry for such a great city? This is the summation, the moral of the story of Jonah. Shouldn't I feel compassion? Shouldn't I mourn for a people who literally, it says, 120,000 people who don't know their right hand from their left? Now, what does that mean? See, the Ninevites were sensitive to their wickedness, but they were still so oblivious to the God of the Israelites. They needed to be taught and mentored and discipled. There was a further work to be done here in Nineveh. I remember Keith Green so many years ago, that contemporary Christian singer, back in my day anyhow, he writes the song like this: "Do you see? Do you see all the people sinking down? Don't you care? Don't you care? Are you gonna let them drown? God's calling and you're the one, but like Jonah, you run. He's told you to speak, but you keep holding it in. God's wish for his creation is salvation, not destruction. Look, God is even concerned with the lowly cattle, and he will work to see that salvation accomplished even when he sees only but a modicum of willingness, a fraction of surrender and faith, and God will respond positively. He'll run and offer his mercy and love. Can any believer resent the magnanimous grace that God has for all people, for all the nations in the world? Yes, there is a great chasm that exists between how Jonah feels towards others and how God feels about others. And maybe there's a chasm in your heart as well. God and Jonah couldn't be more unlike here. What of you? See, the protagonist of the story is God, who loves the people of Nineveh enough to spare them and have great compassion on them. Should I not be concerned, or literally compassionate? Did I not have compassion? The antagonist of the story is the highly moralistic, religious, judgmental, ethnically phobic prophet Jonah, who cares more about his precious shade tree that has perished rather than the perishing of thousands of people. The antagonist is the Nineveh hater, Jonah, the religious racist. I hope you're realizing that Jonah is a very bad role model, not one to be emulated. See, it's simple here. This is what, for me, it sums up to be. Compassion for all creation is God's expectation. That's his heart. Should be ours as well. Your faithfulness towards God is proven by how well you love others. Compassion is the radioactive core of the gospel, the center of all true religion, the very heart of God. That God so loved the world that he gave his son, and he wants the whole world to know it. God has never made a person he doesn't love. God has never made a person he hasn't wanted in heaven. God has never made a person that Jesus didn't die for. God loves every size, every shape, every skin color, every personality type. He loves us all. He loves the nations, and he wants them to know. We are to be an every nation congregation here. Jonah went outside the city to condemn it, but Jesus was dragged outside the city to save it. What a difference. God calls Jonah to go to the great city in chapters 1, 2, and 3. And God is not going to let Jonah off the hook and ignore this calling, but to go and love that great big city of Nineveh, to leave Israel, where everybody looked like him, talked like him, believed like him, and go instead to a place of great diversity, the big city of Nineveh, out of a safe place into a place of risk. And may I say, this is not a unique kind of call. Many centuries later, the Messiah would come on the scene, and after he had won the victory over sin and death, he would command this of his disciples. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And that's it. We call it the Great Commission. He commands his disciples to go and bring the good news to all nations, to leave their places of comfort, to leave their leafy trees behind and go to the nations, to the world, to the Ninevehs. Now, it's so easy for the saints to want to stay isolated from the moral pollution of Nineveh, to stay outside of the city and not bring the truth, the good news, to those who are perishing. The message of Jonah is very clear, that we're to have God's heart. We're to care for what he cares for, who he cares about, people who are far from him, that they receive his mercy. We who've experienced God's mercy should be the most merciful on the planet. And we who've been greatly forgiven should be greatly forgiving. But Jonah never got it. Never got over his sin of prejudice. When we leave him at the end of this book, he is still the bitter, cynical, and angry man that he was at the start. He was still, you guessed it, stuck on stupid. How about you? Will you love the way God wants you to love? Or will we just stay stuck on stupid? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the grace and mercy and love of God that has come to us. And Lord, now it's our turn. It's our turn to respond with your love for this world and to shine your light upon those who desperately need to know. Father, perhaps for each one of us, there's somebody that you're calling our attention to, somebody that's on our mind right now who just needs to know, who needs to be loved into the kingdom. And so God, starting this week, we're going to start loving them. We're going to start loving on them, and we're going to pray for them every single day, hoping that God, you're going to reach them. Use us. Use us as the witnesses and the people who can bring forth just the message of the gospel into their lives. Thank you so much for this day, for this time. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you all. Thanks for listening.
Hey everyone, and once again, welcome to Faith. My name is Matt, and here's everything happening inside Faith Church right now. If you're new with us today, we want to welcome you to Faith Church, and we're so glad that you're here. And to celebrate, we would love to pledge a $5 donation to a charity of your choosing out of our pockets. All you gotta do is head to faithauburn.info and click the link that says Connect Card. And once you do that, we'll send you an email asking which charity you wish us to donate to. And that's it. So you can do this right now. Take out your phone and head to faithauburn.info and we can pledge that $5 donation today in your name. Well, many of our small groups take a break for the summer, but that doesn't mean that community takes a vacation. We wanted to create an informal opportunity for some of you who are new or not yet connected to meet some of the staff and some other members of the church. And so today we're going to be hosting an ice cream social in our lobby at 12:30 p.m. This is for all ages and for anybody, and it's a great way to get to know others in the church. But we'd ask you to just RSVP so that we know how much ice cream to purchase. RSVP at faithauburn.info and let us know that you're coming. We hope to see you this afternoon. For all of their signups and next steps, be sure to visit faithauburn.info. That is everything happening inside Faith right now. Let's continue in our service.
We are so glad that you can tune in this morning. Let us worship our God together.
I was buried beneath my shame.
Come on.
Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing.
Thank you again for joining us today. We believe that there's a next step for you to take to further connect with God and with other people. And if you're new with us, we would invite you to fill out that connect card and let us know that you're new. You can do that by heading to faithauburn.info and clicking the link that says connect card. Another simple next step is to share this service to your own Facebook page. We believe that God has surrounded you with other people who need the good news, the gospel. And sharing the service is a great way to start the conversation. Another way to further connect is by attending one of our in-person services, which happen every Sunday at 9 or 11 a.m. For all other signups and next steps, visit faithauburn.info. We would love to help you get connected this season. Thanks again for watching. We hope you have a great week.